Good morning, saints. Good morning, saints. To God be the glory for another great day that we have come together to worship and praise our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. On behalf of our pastor, Reverend Dr. Jendayo Grady, we welcome you. We invite you to share this service with your friends and your family. We invite you to chat in the chat box and let us know what you're thinking. I'm excited today because this is the second Sunday in February. And as you know, February, we celebrate Black History Month. And there are so many people that deserve to be celebrated. When I think about Dr. Emil Greeley, he's the one who designed and developed the very fastest computer in all the earth. When I think about Dr. Shirley Jackson, she's the one who invented the touch-tone phone. And then I think about Thomas Jennings. He was the one that received the first patent, African-American patent, and it was for dry cleaning, something that we all use. Then you know recently the HBCUs have really taken a hit with the bomb threats. So today I want to lift up our own Howard University, because Howard University is the first university to formulate an African-American sorority from the Alpha Kappa Alpha sorority. A sorority that service is to all mankind as their motto and their theme. So I say to you, let's celebrate. Let's celebrate God. Let's celebrate Jesus. Let's celebrate the Holy Spirit. Let's celebrate African Americans, and let's celebrate Black History Month. Now, we will be treated to a special service today because the word is coming from none other than our own Reverend Dolores Claire. And I ask that you pray with her, pray for her, as she brings a word from the Lord straight to us, that it would pierce our souls and our spirits. Amen, amen, and amen. Are you ready to go higher in praise and worship through song? Levites, come on and bless us in song.
Oh Lord, I'll be reading for your hearing Psalm 8 in the English Standard Version, verses 1 through 9. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouth of babies and infants, you have established strength because of your foes, to steal the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him, and the son of man that you care for him? Yet you have made him a little lower than the heavenly beings, and crowned him with glory and honor. You have given him dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, and also the beast of the field, the birds of the heavens, and the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the paths of the seas. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Let the hearers and the doers of his word be blessed.
Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Please bow your heads if you're able. Most gracious and heavenly Father, we come to you on this Sunday morning, God, praising your holy and your righteous name. We come to you, God, with open hearts and open minds, and we open up, Father God, that you would come in, Father God, and that you would be in control of us, that you would be in control of this service as we hear a word from you. God, we ask that you have your way in this service. And I thank you, Father, for this morning, because all I could think about was your grace and the grace that is sufficient because it comes from you. God, allow us to continue to grow, to come to a better understanding of what Paul meant when he said to be content. To be content, God, not in the things that we have, not in the places we go, not in the gifts and talents that we have. All of those things are great, God, how you bless us. But to be content in knowing that you love us, that your grace is for us, that your grace is in us, and your grace is sufficient. Father, please continue to keep the pastor of this house, the Reverend Dr. Jendayo K. Grady, and the First Lady of this house, Kelly Grady, and their children. Continue to watch over them. Continue to keep a hedge of protection all around them, Father God. Let them not be in need of anything, Father God, and bless them with the desires of their heart. I ask, God, that you will continue to bless the leaders of this church, that you would keep us physically strong, that you would keep us mentally strong, that you would take us especially spiritually strong, God. Allow us to continue to read your word, to learn who you are. Last Sunday, Reverend Sandra Glenn went through extensively of your characteristics and who you are. When we come to know who you are, we walk in confidence. We pray in confidence. We live in confidence because we serve an almighty God who is more than able to meet us at our place of need and carry us and direct us and guide us to the purpose that you have for our lives. We thank you, God, for Jesus. We thank you for the series that we just completed. We thank you, Father God, for how you have taught us and you're teaching us how to get to know Jesus, why we get to know Jesus. God, you have blessed us over and over and over again. God, we ask that you bless the preacher of the hour, the Reverend Dolores Clare. Let her words be clear, filled with clarity and conciseness, God, that her word comes forth in the way that you intended for it to come across, in the way that she heard it from you. God, we thank you. We give your name all the honor. We give your name all of the glory. And yes, we're still going through a lot in this country. It's up, it's down, it's all around. But God, you are the center of our joy. So keep us, God. Keep us at that place as we work through this time here on earth. Until that day you say, well done, thy good and thy faithful servant, and you call us home to glory. God, we honor you, we magnify you, we lift you up. You are worthy for every good and for every perfect gift in our lives comes from you. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen and amen.
I'll be committed to you. I'll never leave you. Nothing in this world could make me walk away. No matter what life may bring, no matter what you face, you won't be lonely. Because forever is a long time, and that's how long I'll love you. That's how long I'll love you. Forever. Forever is a long time, and that's how.
Praise the Lord, everybody. This is Pastor Grady, and I am so excited to worship with you today. I am also excited because this is an opportunity for us to give back to God. It is giving time, and we at the Prince of Peace Community Church and Healing Center, we count it as a privilege to return back to God a portion of all that He has richly entrusted unto us. And so I invite you to bring, to present, to offer your tithes and offering unto the Lord. What is a tithe? A tithe is simply 10% of all God has blessed you with. For example, if your paycheck is $1,000, then your tithe is $100. If your paycheck is $100, then your tithe is $10. Let me give you briefly three reasons why we ought to present our tithes and offerings to the Lord. The first reason, and perhaps the most compelling reason why we ought to bring our tithes and offerings unto the Lord, is to obey God's instructions, to obey God's instructions. In Malachi 3:10, God commands us to bring the full tithe to the storehouse, that there will be food in my house. It is not optional. I know sometimes we think tithe is optional, but it's not optional. It's obligatory. It is mandatory. And so the greatest motive for why we should bring our tithes and offering to the Lord, it's to obey his imperative command. Obey God's instruction. Well, the second reason why we ought to bring our tithes and offering to the Lord is an opportunity to be generous with our income. Listen to what the Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 through 8. The point is this: whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver, and God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work. The Apostle Paul is simply saying that when we give and so liberally out of the generosity of our heart, God will ensure that we have the sufficiency, that we have everything we need at all times to do all that he has called us to do, including minister to the least of these. Because when we minister to the least of these, we are directly ministering to the Lord Jesus Christ. And the third reason why we ought to present our tithes and offerings unto the Lord is because when we offer our tithes and offering, we are offering a great investment. Our offering is a great investment. It's like a wise farmer who plants good seed into good soil, and that farmer is guaranteed a great harvest. Or an investor who invests in the bank of heaven, and that banker is, that investor is guaranteed to receive exponential return on his or her investment. And so let us pray as we prepare to give. Eternal God, our Father, thank you for giving us all of these resources. We ask that you convict our hearts so that we give out of generosity and not out of guilt, out of a cheerful heart and not being coerced, that you would take this tithe and offering, that you would bless it and break it and multiply it and accomplish everything you set out to accomplish for your name's sake. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The three ways to give are listed on the screen. Listen, we are blessed. We are blessed in the city. We are blessed in the field. We are blessed when we come and when we go. So let us continue to take this service higher and higher as we worship the Lord our God. Amen.
Let me hear you sing, bless, bless, bless. In the morning, in the noonday, in the nighttime, we're blessed, bless, 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 bless. We're blessed, we're blessed, we're blessed. Since thou hast walked uprightly as a light in a dark land, since thou hast placed in thy heart all the Lord's command, he set thee above nation and cast thy enemies away. He's standing up within thee, so let me hear you say, we're blessed in the city, we're blessed in the fields, we're blessed when we come and when we go. We cast down every stronghold, sickness and poverty must cease, for the devil. We're blessed.
The sermonic text for this morning will be coming from the book of John, chapter 10, verses 1 through 16. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbs in by another way, that man is a thief and a robber. But he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the gatekeeper opens. The sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. A stranger they will not follow, but they will flee from him, for they do not know the voice of strangers. This figure of speech Jesus used with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So Jesus again said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He who is a hired hand and not a shepherd, who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees, and the wolf snatches them and scatters them. He flees because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And I have other sheep that are not of this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. Amen.
This is my season. Good morning, saints, and praise the Lord, everyone. It is indeed a pleasure and an honor to come before you this morning with a word. I first want to give thanks to my pastor, the Reverend Dr. Jendayo Grady, for allowing me this time with you. The sermonic text has been read for your hearing, but I would like to go back and focus on just a couple of verses from chapter 10, just to bring us up and to refresh what we've already heard. I'll be reading verses 14 through 16. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. And just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay my life down for the sheep. I have other sheep that are not of the sheep pen. I must bring them also. They too will listen to my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd. Our sermon topic for this morning is the Good Shepherd, the Good Shepherd. Let us pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I first of all just want to say thank you. Thank you, Lord God, for another opportunity to speak on your word. Lord God, I've done the best that I know how, so Father, I ask that you would just come in the form of the Holy Spirit and just take control. Do whatever you need to do. Change it, rewrite it, whatever, Lord God. I just ask that you be with me. Stay with me throughout this sermon, Lord God. Speak to me and speak through me. And our Father, I pray that everything that comes from my lips will be from you. All these things I pray in the precious name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. The Good Shepherd. Before I get into the sermon, I always like to go back just a few chapters to put things into proper context. So this morning, I'm going to go back to John chapter 5. From John 5 through John 10, we find Jesus appearing at a series of Jewish festivals. At each festival, he used a metaphor to reveal more profound truths about himself. In each case, Jesus replaced a vital element in the ceremony of the festival with himself. For example, in chapter 6, he referred to himself as the bread of life. In chapter 7, it was the living water. And in chapter 8, it was the light of the world. So as we enter chapter 10, we meet Jesus at the festival of Hanukkah. Some call the Festival of Dedication. Hanukkah was a winter festival that commemorated the rededication of the second Jewish Holy Temple. The temple was desecrated by King Antiochus IV about 200 years before Christ. The damage to the temple made it unfit for ceremonial use. At this Hanukkah celebration, Jesus uses the shepherd theme taken from Ezekiel 34. The shepherd was a common metaphor used as for kings or leaders of the people in the ancient Near East. Jesus used the metaphor of the shepherd to distinguish between himself as the good shepherd and Israel's current religious leaders as bad shepherds. The prophet Ezekiel, in predicting the coming of the Messiah, referred to him as the shepherd. Just as a shepherd cares for his sheep, Jesus, the good shepherd, cares for his flock. His flock includes those who believe in and follow him. He offers access to safety and security. He is our provider, he is our deliverer, and he is our only way to access God. A group of sheep under the care of one shepherd is called a flock. Not unlike mankind, when left without direction or protection, they have a tendency to wander, to stray away from the flock, going off in different directions, left to fend for themselves, doing what they think is right, often coming face to face with life-ending experiences. In Ezekiel 34, Ezekiel the prophet was called by the Lord to prophesy against the shepherds, that is, the former kings and leaders of Israel because they failed to care for their flock, the people of Israel. He criticized Israel's kings and spiritual leaders for taking care of themselves rather than taking care of their people. He accused them of being wicked shepherds who nourished and dressed themselves at the expense of their flock, doing nothing to minister to the need of the ailing or the wounded. The leaders of Israel, that is the political and spiritual leaders, had not taken care of the weak or gone looking for those who had wandered away and who were lost. Instead, they pursued their own interests, feeding themselves at the expense of the people. The neglect and abuse of these cruel shepherds had scattered the Lord's flock across the face of the earth. During the time when Christ walked the earth, the Pharisees were the leaders, the shepherds of the Jewish people. They were mostly middle-class businessmen and leaders of the synagogues. They alone with the Sadducees made up the Sanhedrin, the supreme court of ancient Israel. The Sanhedrin as a body claimed powers that lesser Jewish courts did not have. They were the ones to whom all questions of law were finally put. Although the Pharisees were the minority in the court and they held a minority number of positions as priests, they had the popular support among the people. And therefore, they were able to control the decision-making process. They were the arbiters of spiritual and legal interpretation. So the community looked to them to explain unusual events or happenings they didn't understand. So it was only natural that they looked to their leaders to explain the miracles that took place in John chapter 5, 7, and 9. In John 5, the paralytic man, had spent many years unable to walk and was required to sustain himself by begging. When Jesus healed him on the Sabbath, the leadership, the shepherds of Israel, namely the Pharisees, were more concerned about the rules and laws being broken than the life and health of the paralytic man. The Jewish leaders saw both a mighty miracle of healing and a broken rule. They threw the miracle aside and focused their attention on the broken rule because the rule was more important to them than the miracle. Now, keep in mind that there were some 600 plus laws, some given by God and some written by man, namely the Pharisees. The same group of religious leaders, the Pharisees, had no empathy for the woman caught in the deed of adultery in chapter 7 or the healing of the man born blind in chapter 9. They were more disposed to using them as a ploy to condemn Jesus for contradicting the laws of Moses. Entrenched in their own religious system, they refused to let the Son of God change their lives. They were jealous of the people's reaction to Jesus. They were afraid that Jesus was about to take away the power they had over the people. They knew the laws of Moses and the ones they later added on, but they failed to recognize the Savior. Don't become so involved in religion and tradition that you miss Christ. Always look forward to Christ. The Jewish leaders saw themselves as a group of elitists that alone possessed the truth and therefore resisted the truth about Christ because it wasn't theirs to begin with. They were considered bad shepherds. They blinded themselves to the truth by their own obstinance. They stubbornly adhered to their own opinions in spite of reason, persuasions, or arguments to the contrary. A bad shepherd is not only selfish, but destructive, whether religious or political. He raises unnecessary doubts. He teaches false doctrines and acts sinfully. He confuses and destroys the confidence and hope of the people, all for the sake of position and prestige. We are all shepherds of one kind or another. It's important to remember that true leadership focuses on helping others, not just getting ahead. Never become blind to the truth when it's standing right in front of you. In the book of John, chapter 9, verse 40, the Pharisees were shocked, literally shocked, that Jesus thought they were spiritually blind. When you get so entrenched in believing one thing versus another, it's easy to be blind or unable to recognize the truth when you hear it. So it was for the Pharisees. Instead of listening to the truth spoken by Jesus, they instead tried to use his words against them in an effort to destroy him. You see, it is easy to get caught up in man-made structures that we create. God cannot hear us or speak to us if we are building walls of self-deception, deceiving ourselves into believing one thing or another. Jesus presents himself as the only good shepherd, one who will care for the need of his flock, one who will protect and provide for them, keeping them safe from the perils and dangers that fall upon them, leaving none behind to perish. People tend to want to restrict God's blessings to their own groups, but Jesus refuses to be limited by fences we build. Verses 14 through 16, I again say, I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. And just as the Father knows me, and I know the sheep, and I lay my life down for the sheep. I have other sheep that are not of this sheep pen. I must bring them also. They too will listen to my voice, excuse me. And there shall be one flock and one shepherd. Here Jesus shows that his mission is worldwide. As a good shepherd, the other sheep that he refers to are not the Jews, but the Gentiles, which includes you and me. His flock comes in all sizes, shapes, and colors. To Jesus, diversity is not a stranger. He died on the cross, not just for the Jews, but the world, giving the best he had to offer to all of those who chose to follow and believe in him. Jesus was not merely doing a job. He was and is committed to not only love us, but to love us unconditionally. He even laid down his life for us. God was the shepherd of Israel, but the spiritual and political leaders of Israel, not unlike our leaders today, were also given the responsibility for being shepherds of God's people, the flock of God. Pseudo shepherds promised the sheep the good life, but more often than not, they fail to bring it to fruition. This month, we are celebrating Black History Month. We as a people find ourselves living in historic times. We are not only the people of color, but the people of this country as a whole are indeed in need of good shepherds. As a nation, we see division among its citizens brought on by leaders who were assigned the task of working not for an individual, but for America as a whole. Unity and bipartisanship has become a thing of the past, replaced by an attitude of separatism and exclusivity, where position and status have become more important than the welfare of the country. They have 2020 vision, but are spiritually blind. The happenings of today bring back vivid memories of the past. It brings back memories of a time when segregation and discrimination were the norm, not the exception. Memories of a long time of persecution and separatism. Most of you, or some of you, have never actually seen the colored sign posted over a water fountain, unless you saw it on television or in the movies. You have never seen the sign colored balconies in the movie theaters, or experienced laws that required you as a Black person to sit in the back of the bus. And most of you have never gone to a restaurant where you were not allowed to enter through the front door, but through a back or a side door. Most of you have never seen a time when you were unable to register to vote or buy property the property of your choice, or a time where you had to attend segregated schools. Now, even though we have made monumental steps forward in the past 50 or 60 years or so, today it seems as though the leadership of this country is trying to take us back in history, back to a time of hatred, hostility, and separatism. Partisanship is at an all-time high. It no longer matters what you think, believe, or feel on the inside. The oath you swore to uphold is no longer important. Instead, retaining status and position has become the determinant factor in the decision-making process. It takes you back to the time of the Pharisees, when the power was in their hands. But today, as a black woman, I am so very thankful for the good shepherds we as a people have experienced in times past. Those who, with the help of God, enabled us to realize the progress we have made thus far. I am thankful for Dr. King, a good shepherd who believed and fought for unity and justice for all, not just a select few, giving his very life in the service of his countrymen. Even though we have yet to realize all of the things he dreamed about, I am so thankful that he dared to dream, because maybe one day that table of brotherhood that he so passionately spoke of may actually come to fruition. I am thankful that God gave us the opportunity to witness the election of the first black president of these United States, one who believed that all Americans are connected in ways that transcend political, cultural, and geographical differences. One that believed that together we can make the world a better place. One who believed in the unification of all people, creating one flock, knowing the truth of the quote, "The whole is better than the sum of its parts." I am thankful for all of the good shepherds in time past. Harriet Tubman, Rosa Parks, Fannie Lou Hamer, Sojourner Truth, John Lewis, Elijah Cummings, Medgar Evers, Thurgood Marshall, and many, many more. Those who answered the call did not walk away, but felt it their duty to stand firm in the face of adversity for what they believed. Those who stood strong when summoned by God to the daunting task of fighting for civil rights. Those who suffered under the water hoses of the South. Those who died in the course of fighting for what they believed. Those who fought on to change the course of history. Those men and women who literally poured their lives out in the service and best interests of their fellow countrymen. But today, we must look beyond the historical first. We must see the acts of sacrifice. Many of us are basking in the victories they achieved with no regard for the sacrifices they made. They were good shepherds who were not spiritually blind. We here today are living, experiencing the fruit of their labor. So when you enter into a restaurant of your choice through the front door, and not the side or the back, when you approach a water fountain and take a drink, or when you sit in the balcony by choice and not because you are not allowed to sit anywhere else, when you select and attend the school of your choice, or are able to buy a better home for yourself, or get a better job simply because you're qualified, don't take it for granted. Stop and think about the sacrifice. When you refuse to vote because there is no one on the ticket that you really like, or you think about the good shepherds that sacrificed their life for your right to vote. Think about Medgar Evers, who was assassinated in his driveway because he dared to fight for his and our right to vote. And then take it a little higher and think about the one that walked beside those who went before us, a good shepherd. One who paved the way, not only for the Jews, but the Gentiles as well. The one who did not forget about you and me. The one who did not forget about us. The one who didn't and still don't care about race, gender, or nationality, but only what's written on the tablets of your heart. It was the Lord who stood up in the brave men and women who have gone before us, who fought, bled, and died for us, so that we might one day realize the same rights and privileges as other people in this country. Because of the Good Shepherd, Jesus the Christ, all of the marching, bleeding, and dying of our forefathers will not be in vain. We too are shepherds of one kind or another. We have a responsibility to stand up and be counted as ambassadors of Christ. If we, the members of this flock, placed in this house by God, will stand up and tear down the fences and the walls that we ourselves have built. If we will not only listen, but actually hear and apply to our lives the phenomenal teachings that we are privy to every Sunday and every Sunday and every second and fourth Tuesday of the month by the Good Shepherd placed in this house called Prince of Peace, we too will be counted among the sheep that will march through the gate called Jesus the Christ, straight into eternal life, where all of the marching, bleeding, and dying will be over. We must look to the hills from which cometh our help. Our help cometh from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore. Matthew 6:33 says, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you." Get your heart right first. If you're going to march, march standing on the word of God. If you're going to testify, testify about the goodness of God and what he has done for you. Jesus is a good shepherd that won't leave you nor forsake you. He's always standing right beside you, hovering over you, protecting and providing for you. Don't go through life with blinders on or hiding behind fences and walls that only exist in your mind. Pray to God to open your spiritual eyes that you may see, and your spiritual ears that you may hear, and your mind that you may fully understand and apply the true word of God to your life today, not tomorrow, not next week, but today. Don't be like the shepherds leading our country today, or the Pharisees of time past. Shepherds that are so filled up with the need of status, power, and position, that self-gratification is the only thing that matters, regardless of the cost to others or the country. Don't be like the Pharisees, who are so entrenched in religion that they miss the Savior, even when he's standing right in front of you. Don't go through life with 20/20 vision, but spiritually blind. Don't miss the Savior when he is standing right in front of you. To God be the glory. If you're seeking salvation, or if you're already saved, we would love to have you come and join us here at Prince of Peace. We are a loving church, a worshiping church, and a praising church. And we are a family that's growing and maturing in the Word of God. And if this is for you, just text connect to the number on the screen. Text connect to the number on the screen. We welcome you. We would love to have you to come and grow with us.
At the mention of your name, every knee must bow, every tongue confess that you are Lord. Yes, you are. At the mention of your name, every knee must bow, every tongue confess that you are Lord. Yes, you are. 'Cause at the mention of your name, every knee must bow, every tongue confess that you are Lord. Yes, you are. Jesus, you are Lord. Oh, oh, oh. Jesus, you
mention of your name, the scales fall from their eyes. Once blinded eyes will see that you are Lord. Yes, you are. So at the mention of your name, the scales fall from their eyes. Once blinded eyes can see that you are.